Hi, I'm Anuradha Sengupta, and on this show, we have talked a lot about how streaming or OTT services have captured the imagination. What I really like is how they've broken the stranglehold of big-budget mainstream movies, daily soaps, and of Hindi on the pan-Indian consciousness, broadening our horizons and our minds in the process, leading this wave of authentic and exciting stories and storytelling for some time now is Malayalam cinema. To find out what's fueling the creative surge here and to understand the economics and if these economics will sustain, I'm talking to a few people who are in the thick of it. So please welcome Vijay Subramaniam. He's director and content head at Amazon Prime Video. Cinematographer Sanu John Varghese, who's just released his first film as director. And finally, the very popular actor-producer Fahad Fazil, who has become, in a natural, organic way, the face of the Malayalam cinema I'm talking about. Gentlemen, it is lovely to see all of you. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you so much.
So, Fahad, I'm going to start with you. This kind of spotlight or limelight that Malayalam cinema finds itself in over the past year, is this, you think, the happy outcome of an extraordinary human experience, which is COVID-19 and the lockdown? Or is this the streaming service delivering that pan-Indian audience to, in quotes, niche content? Or is it something beyond that? What is happening? What is your assessment of what's going on?
So I think there are it's a lot of things eventually came together to make this happen, and primarily I think it's the audience ready to explore things outside their understanding. For someone sitting in Bombay to watch a Malayalam film, it's definitely the person taking an effort to read the subtitles or read about the film elsewhere and come back to the film. So I think it's a lot of things changing. Basically, people and the geography around them, our current situation, the crisis the world is facing. So it's, I think, a lot of things, come together. Mm. And about Malayalam cinema, I think it's a cycle. There was a time we would really discuss about Marathi films.
Yes.
There was a time we would really talk about Tamil films. So I think it's a cycle, and assuming in the next 2 years it'll be just cinema, and cinema will represent everything that happens here.
Right, Vijay, is it a cycle? Because you do commission films in various languages, including Hindi, Malayalam, Tamil, Telugu. Is there a buzz about Malayalam cinema in at least in social media, word of mouth? And if that is, why is that happening, you think? What is your sense of what's happening?
Well, I think it's a couple of reasons. One is Indian tastes and preferences are really diverse. And I think it's important for us to stop calling this cinema regional and just call it local. To someone on the streets of Kollam, Hindi is a local language spoken in Mumbai and Delhi. So I think it's really important to acknowledge that these are local tastes and preferences that we are paying a lot of attention to. Customers have been paying attention to it for a long, long time. And that's the first reason. The second is, storytelling forms differ from region to region because they're influenced so deeply by cultures and microcultures, and Malayalam cinema is no different. I mean, growing up, I've grown up on a staple diet of South Indian cinema, and Malayalam was always the typical spear when it came to comedy to begin with. So Malayalam cinema in many ways has pioneered storytelling trends, which then have gone on to find favor with other communities and other storytellers. And that's the second. And the third is just where we are as a country, right? The thing is, everything that all our efforts have been towards promoting local cinema, and not just to the diaspora that cares about it, but helping other people from other parts of the country discover great content. And I think that's a great role that Prime Video plays, and that's possible because A, we're making the discovery of content very easy.
Very easy. And you also have promotion budgets, right, to back up the films or the content that you want to put out there. I mean, look, the front pages of newspapers these days are very often ads from streaming services, and especially the large global ones, isn't it? I'm going to get Sanu in here. Sanu, you've worked across industries. You've just made this very assured, accomplished debut as director. Is it different what's going on today in the in Malayalam cinema as compared with other industries? What are you seeing? And you know, Namrata Joshi, this journalist, wrote this wonderful piece in The Guardian about how perhaps the industry in Kerala was most adept or nimble in doing stories which reflect the current zeitgeist.
I've said earlier this, it's actually a privilege to talk to the Malayalam audience. I mean, that's what I believe. I couldn't have gone and, you know, made what I made in another language, because I would always think about, you know, the market realities. And that's probably one place where we could push the boundaries. We have been, I've been part of a few movies which have, tried to do that. So it, you know, gave me the courage to do that, but only in Malayalam. I think it's a privilege to be dealing with that audience.
Is there something in the fact that you have a captive audience in lockdown, which saw a surge in digital viewing, streaming services, finding bigger audiences? Do you see the audiences you're getting today, Pan India, and the chattering classes, of course, do you see this as a natural, happy outcome of the COVID-19 pandemic experience and the Kerala film industry's ability to put out stories which were rooted and yet very universal?
I look at the positive side of the whole thing. I possibly see the emergence of a newer market where there's scope to, tell stories which you couldn't tell with a, lot of market conviction earlier. I think, there's that kind of a market emerging. I see, lot of people who are my, Bombay friends who are from other states, other cultures completely. Even people living abroad, getting hooked onto Malayalam cinema just because of the quality of the content that, Malayalam cinema is putting out there. I think it opens the possibility of larger market emerging, and I'm, as a storyteller, I'm hoping that I can tell some stories that I couldn't have told in the Malayalam reality as such earlier.
Fahad, you have Malik coming up. Now that was scheduled for last year, pushed to early this year, and now going straight to streaming. How much is the theatrical business not being there or being absent affected the economics of movie making?
See, I mean, it's definitely affected in the sense that with a film like Malik, which is usually bigger than a normal Malayalam film, we've waited with it for 2 years. To make a film and wait with the film for 2 years, that's, it doesn't get the numbers or the economics right at any point, So, sure. And I primarily believe that every narrative has an expiry. So my concern with this entire thing of holding a film was, we are running out of time with the narrative. Let's just see what audience think. And I thought it was a decision. Need for the time. And I'm looking forward for the theaters to reopen and how the, how things regain normalcy. And I strongly believe these two platforms will coexist, it's very important for these two platforms to coexist and then grow together.
I think it's important to hear you both as an actor and as a producer to say that, isn't it? Because exhibitors are very clearly, obviously, and vocally worried about their own futures, isn't it?
Very much, very much. And see, it's two different kind of cinema, I see it as two different narratives and, the kind of things that you would want to discuss. It's two different, entirely two different writing. We basically, when we sit with friends, the change is actually with the writing. Everything else remains the same. Rest of the, craft remains the same. It's the writing that changes.
We saw See You Soon, we saw Joji, and we are now going to see Malik. Do you want to very quickly I know it actually warrants a much longer discussion, but would it be possible for you to illustrate with these three films about how the writing determines the scale and therefore the platform on which a film will probably fit more naturally?
No, so at the writing stage, the only concern, the only thing that we take care of is the content needs to be entertaining. We don't decide on the, the maths or the, how to pitch it. I mean, while making it, the idea is to make it honestly and see, especially with See You Soon. And I didn't even know Vijay when I did See You Soon. So when I did it, I didn't know how I was going to show it to the people. So the only thing I told everyone was that we'll start a YouTube channel and put it there. Mm. So You know, I mean, the idea was to make a film and see if anyone would be interested. And I still keep doing that. You know, I'll make a film and I'll call up people and ask them, you know, do you want this? Hmm. So I've been constantly doing that, you know.
You call up people and say, do you want it? Vijay, do you, is it even an option to say no these days to this gentleman?
No.
And you know, by the way, there are people who say that at the moment you guys are so in love with anything Fahad does that, you know, most of your attention is going to him, and there are a whole bunch of other people and other movies that need a bit of attention. Is that a charge say yes to?
No, not at all.
No.
Not at all. In fact, if anything, our bar for quality cinema is pretty high overall. And it's a matter of coincidence that whether it's Dilish, Mahesh, and Fahad, their combination of storytelling has actually met our standards, and it's just a matter of sequencing that we have so many. I mean, to be honest, it would be unfair to all the other creators who also given us great hits, whether it's Surarai Potru in Tamil or whether it's Drishyam 2 from Jeetu Joseph in Malayalam. The list is pretty long. I think it's important to also acknowledge the fact that for us, there are two things that serve customers well. One is the quality itself. So everything that we do, whether it's our films or our series, they're all cinematic in nature. That's one. And two, we're very particular about being able to give the creators the bandwidth they need to tell the stories they want to tell. And I think a lot is being made right now, Anuradha, about the whole economics and whether the theaters are the right. Is this something that's going to be permanent, et cetera, et cetera. And I couldn't agree with Fahad more. You know, these mediums are going to coexist, and the consumer, she's pretty smart. She's going to make choices as she's always had in terms of what to watch where. Two fun facts. At a time like this, when distribution, traditional distribution within the state is challenging and externally is even more, 50% of the viewership for all our regional cinema that we've premiered on the service in the last year or so has come from outside the origin state. This goes back to the earlier point of, you know, the ease of distribution and reach and the marketing point that you made. Hmm. Interestingly, not only has it gone beyond the origin state within the country, we have people from over 170 countries watching this cinema. And depending on the film, the regional film that we're talking, or the local film we're talking about, anywhere between 15 and 20% of its viewership is actually coming from these countries.
Right.
Now, juxtapose this with traditional distribution and ask the producer the same question. How many hoops would they have to jump through to get this kind of reach available instantly across the world at the flick of a switch?
Sanu, this is the point for me to bring you in. We're just talking about reach. What does this reach translate into in terms of revenues? I mean, your producer, what has the experience been with Arcarium, given that you've also released on a Kerala streaming service, a Kerala-specific streaming service as well, isn't it?
I don't really know about the revenues part of it that well, but I don't see the happiness I don't see the unhappiness when I talk to the producer. So I think it's all well and good. That's where I would leave it. But extending what I was saying earlier, what Vijay is saying, the point about it being able to cross over to other states other than its state of origin, is a huge thing which I see, because my film deals with metro reality and an extremely local reality. People from across could kind of connect to it, but if the content is not reaching that audience, then it goes pointless. And that's what I learned from this. The other markets where this can connect to it, it definitely opens up the possibilities of that.
Right. Fahad, would you be doing content or stories which were different in nature if you didn't have this platform or these kinds of streaming platforms, whichever one it may be?
Very interesting question, actually. So, I wouldn't do anything that I'm not excited about.
Sure.
But consciously, when I said there's a difference, I think there's a difference writing for someone sitting with the remote, and there's a difference writing for someone who's like just watching it.
Yeah.
So I think the difference is there, and I'm just exploring the possibilities of actually for a more interactive home viewing.
So when you say interactive home viewing, you mean using technology to sort of enhance the equation or relationship between the viewer and the filmmaker and the film that's out there, or you know, or the show that's
yeah, you
out
can,
there,
you can decide,
like
you can
Black see. Mirror or whatever, right? At some
close to that. So
wow.
I spoke to Mahesh, you know, see, Malik basically talks about three perspectives of a particular incident. So I told Mahesh, you know, make it interactive. Let audience see, let them decide which perspective to see. You know, they'll only get to see one perspective. They'll either get to see my perspective or my mother's perspective or my friend's perspective. You know, so in a sense that, you know, there'll be a lot more interactions that way. And
that's so exciting for, you know, for someone like you, Sanu, you know, all the creative people, Vijay, this is all terribly exciting, isn't it? Is it? Are we ready yet to do stuff like this, Fahad?
Vijay has to answer that.
He's going to sign off, isn't it, on the budgets that all this will require?
Well, not actually. It's the way I see it, Anuradha, is it's actually truly customer backwards, and this is going to creep up on us. It's going to evolve. It'll never be revolutionary. These things just, you know, the bubble to the top, and before you know it, this is already happening. And that's really because I personally believe, and all of us at Amazon believe, that the customer's she's a very divinely dissatisfied person. And she's pretty smart. She's always going to seek evolution in the way stories are told. If you just track back a couple of years, if you had to find out anything about a film as you were watching it, you would have to make a mental note, then go on to Google and then search for it, etc., etc. Right now, you on Prime Video at least, you hit pause, you get X-ray features, you just go there. Find out who's acted in it, who's written it, who's directed it, and then you want to know other works. Everything shows up, and before you know it, your journey of discovery is well and truly begun.
And this non-linear world, isn't it? Because I saw Fahad in Kumbhalingi Nights, and then I just went on some journey and I saw a couple of films, Fahad, I have to admit, without subtitles on Prime Video. And I did see a couple without subtitles. Then I said, this is too much. You can't get so carried away by a new discovery. But having said that, Sanu, retrofitting to the customer. I mean, you know, when Vijay is talking that kind of language, and then when you want to do these stories as an author, as what you want to write and then direct, where is the intersection between these two worlds?
Fahad said earlier, the writing actually is completely different. I mean, you know, every time you write, you are actually writing backward from how it would be consumed. Whether you write it for cinema, you consider the realities of how long you can, you know, guys who have bought the ticket and come in, the captive audience, how long you can, you know, hold them, how long you can bore them. You count all those things while you write for a theater film. The viewing, which is more personal, the OTT viewing with a remote, you need to, write in, you know, how it engages with that kind of an audience. You need to count that in while you write. You do the same adjustment when you make advertising films.
Yeah.
Because it's an extremely... My parents watch advertising always mute. So I've been telling all my advertising friends, you know, we need to tackle this. It has to travel on the visual, not on the sound, because it's mute most of the places. So that kind of adjustment will have to be made. And, you know, we'll need to understand that medium better, understand how to craft for that medium better. You need to study. It's a reality. But multiple narrative possibilities will emerge with the way VR is going and stuff, probably. Or something which uses all of this, some other medium would come up. You know, storytelling will go on, is what the hope.
Yes. But thematically, do you see more political films coming in? I'm not saying that we haven't seen political films. We've seen gender politics. We've seen family politics play out in many of the films that we are seeing. But political... in the sense of the political environment and the reality today that we live in, Kerala, there is no state which is perhaps more vociferously politically conscious than Kerala is, and the average Malayali is. Do you see that being a very interesting area to mine for storytelling? Which I don't look so uncomfortable.
No, I think, see...
you haven't seen Malik yet.
Okay.
Yeah. So I was just thinking about that. You know, as she was asking me that question, I was just thinking about that. So I think see what's important is that when you say original film traveling, see a Malayalam film going from Kerala to Bombay or Calcutta or wherever, so primarily what you're excited about is the locality of the storytelling.
I
believe that the more local you go, the more wider you go with the film.
Yeah.
You know, so
the more universal its reach in a sense. Yeah.
Absolutely. So that detailing is important. That detailing can be political. That detailing can be romantic. That detailing can be anything. You know, you can choose that. You can choose from your society. It's then the atmosphere. You just need to pick it up and choose what technique to tell your story. And to answer your question, I think there will be, because they have the freedom to do that, I think more people would want to explore that.
Vijay, quick question on the kind of ROI. What is the return on investment? How do you look at it in broad parameters when you acquire films like you are these days in local Indian languages? How do you gauge whether that has, that has been a worthwhile investment for you or not? Because that's an area where we're not so familiar with at this point of time in the way streamers, especially large global ones like yours, operate.
Yeah, sure. So it's pretty simple, actually. Our goal is to become India's most preferred choice of entertainment. And so everything that we're committing to today and we will in the future keeps that long-term goal in mind. And everything that we calibrate ourselves towards is fundamentally driven by how many subscribers we have, how many we can acquire, how engaged are they. Why is engagement important? Because that's a happiness quotient.
Yeah.
All right, it basically tells us that they like our service or they love our service. And we keep calibrating towards that. And finally, from a film standpoint, it's very important to keep a broader perspective of portfolio in mind, Anuradha, because every title in and of itself comes with its distinct advantages and sometimes with its disadvantages. We plan for portfolio. So if we did not do that, we may miss a very important customer beat of extremely story-led concepts like Joji or Kumbhalangi Nights by biasing towards more of the mainstream stuff. And conversely, by not keeping that balance, we may miss out on the mainstream stuff that, to Fahad's point, really drive entertainment one hell of a lot, whether it's his own movie Trans or whether it's Lucifer or Drishyam 2. So I think for us, the portfolio approach matters. And so even when we make our investments, we always look at the three dimensions, right? Long-term, are we building towards becoming India's most preferred choice of entertainment? Two, are we entertaining the diverse many Indias that we're programming for? That's really key. And three, how effective is the portfolio? And the portfolio is not just a immediate, present and a future-looking one, but it's also when you look back, is the Malayalam portfolio continue to resonate? Is it strong enough?
Fahad, we've got Malik to look forward to. Leave us with closing words on this extraordinary past year that has been, both in terms of life experience and in terms of your own personal journey as an actor, as a craftsperson.
So this is the year, like everyone, I got to spend a lot of time at home. So it was a phase of rediscovery and, you go through that cycle. So so every time you discover new about something yourself, you want to do a film about that or you want to explore that with a film. That's how I function. So that way, this year has been very good and very, in the sense that I've been fortunate that I could come out with such good films and all that. And with Malik again, it's been a very ambitious project. And Malik talks about 30 years of the coastal history of Kerala.
Right. Lovely.
And it's packed with, and it's a very interesting narrative, which is packed with layers of human emotions like hatred, love, revenge, betrayal. There's everything, and it's a beautiful film, and it won't harm you.
Sanu, tip of the iceberg, movies like yours, there's a lot more from where that came from.
Definitely. I mean, there's a certain direction in which it goes and there's, you all of a sudden something works and it opens out, floodgates of possibility of, content which can travel in other directions. I think it's just going to grow in a very nice direction for a while. As Fahad said, it's cyclical, but you know, I think we are on the upturn of it.
Fahad, are you enjoying the attention from the rest of India?
Well, I started, you know, when I started 10 years back, I was not sure if Malayalis would watch my films. And this is like, you know,
happy bonus.
You know, way beyond what I asked for. You know, I'm just fortunate, and I'm just thankful to the team that you know, I don't do this alone.
Of course,
I think it's a
so collaborative, you know,
constant collaborative effort. So, you know, we are thankful to the attention we are getting now, and especially with Amazon, and you know. It's easier to reach out to audience.
You feel a lot of gratitude. So do we. Thank you for the choices you're making and the stories you all are all telling and bringing to us. I wish you all a lot of good
luck.
Stay safe, stay well. And thank you very much for watching. Look out for another conversation on the Media Dialogues on CNBC TV18.